Let's get to the Bible study this evening. Last week, we looked at bondservants. And I told you that the apostles and the disciples of the early church, they looked at themselves as servants of the Lord Jesus Christ. They referred to themselves as bondservants. I told you what that means, but here's the short of it in review. They didn't govern themselves. That's basically at the heart of what a bondservant is. They don't govern themselves. They belong to someone else. And they understood something that many today, unfortunately, don't understand or don't want to understand. And that is this, and it's very simple. I don't belong to myself. I was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. So I don't belong to myself. I don't belong to others. I belong to Him. Now, yes, do I belong to the church and I belong to others? Yes, but primarily I belong to Jesus Christ. I am His. For bondservants, those that today, right, in the year that we're living, would still consider themselves bondservants, and I hope that I'm teaching, I hope that I'm sharing with bondservants this evening. The Word of God is precious to bondservants. The Word of God is precious to me, and it should be to you. It's the manual for life. So when something happens in life, you go to what the Bible says, and it doesn't matter what anybody else is saying. You just put all your faith and all your trust in the Bible. I just go to the Bible. What's happening in the world? What is this person saying or that person saying? Doesn't matter. It doesn't even matter what I think. I just go to the Bible. Not Fox News or CNN, like I mentioned last week. And for bondservants, we're not making up our own rules. We're not proclaiming our own destiny, declaring and decreeing things. We're not buckling under the pressure of the culture, not aligning ourselves with politics. We're also not trying to rewrite the Bible as many are trying today. You know what? A lot of pastors and a lot of churches, that's exactly what they're doing. And I gave you a really quick example of this in the church last week. Say, women pastors. I gave you that example last week. The Word of God says that the role of the pastor, that leadership position, is reserved for biblically qualified men, period. Now, you may not like that. And if you don't, your problem isn't with me. I don't have a problem with you. Your problem isn't with me. Your issue is with the Word of God. Please go read 1 Timothy chapter 3, Titus chapter 1, verses 1 through 9, 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 1 through 4. Then you come back and you tell me what you think that says. And I've heard all the excuses. The Bible is antiquated. It doesn't really mean what it says. It was a different era. It was written over 2,000 years ago. I believe in equality. So I don't believe that that's what Paul was saying. Whatever. Look, that's what the Bible says. Look into the Greek of it. Look into all the meanings. And it is what it is. So I don't get into arguments over things like that. You can believe whatever you want. You know what? There are people today that believe the earth is flat. You can believe whatever you want. I choose for myself to believe the Bible, not to go by what people are saying or the culture dictates. So listen to what Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 23. This I take as a mandate to myself. Don't get involved in foolish, ignorant arguments that only start fights. That's not something I'm going to fight over. It's just, it's plain. It's clear in the scriptures. So here's a question that I want to tackle this evening. What does a pastor look like? If you have read those verses, if you went back last week and you read the qualifications of a pastor, you know what they are. But what does it look like? What does the pastor look like? And I'm not talking about appearance. I'm not talking about how tall he is or, you know, what he's wearing or anything, or what he's driving. I'm not talking about appearances. I'm talking character. What is the pastor made of? What's the fiber of the pastor? Well, let me tell you this. The New Testament puts the Apostle Paul, Pastor Paul, on display as the image of the pastor. So, I like to put it this way. The portrait of a pastor in the New Testament is the Apostle Paul. Now, the Good Shepherd Jesus, he is a shepherd overall. But the Bible seems to exalt Paul as the role model that us pastors, every pastor, should aim to model themselves after. Paul said it himself. He said, "Follow me as I follow Christ." Paul wrote a lot of the New Testament, and we know more about his history than we do anyone else. So what if Pastor Paul was to take a selfie of himself? The qualifications of a pastor take that as a silhouette, right? As a shadow. But what does that look like when we put flesh and blood on it? And I'm here to say to you, at least to propose this to you, that it looks like the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul. The shadow becomes a person. The shadow, the qualifications become the person in the Apostle Paul. So thankfully, look, Paul has taken several New Testament selfies of what he looks like, thankfully, right? And I'm very, very happy that Paul talks about himself a little bit in, you know, Corinthians and in the book of Acts. We're going to look at this. Turn with me to Acts chapter 20. Paul's taking a selfie of himself. That's the best as I can describe it to you. Acts chapter 20, beginning in verse 17. From Miletus, he sent to Ephesus. This is Paul. Paul sent to Ephesus and called for the elders of the church. So these are the Ephesian elders. And when they had come to him, he said to them, "You know, from the first day that I came to Asia, in what manner I always lived among you, serving the Lord with all humility, with many tears and trials, which happened to me by the plotting of the Jews, how I kept back nothing that was helpful, but proclaimed it to you, and taught you publicly and from house to house, testifying to Jews and also to Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. And see, now I go bound in the Spirit to Jerusalem, not knowing the things that will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit does in fact testify in every city, saying that chains and tribulations await me." Verse 24, "But none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself, so that I may finish my race with joy and the ministry which I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. And indeed, now I know that you all among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God will see my face no more. Therefore, I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all men, for I have not shunned to declare to you the whole counsel of God. Therefore, take heed to yourselves and to all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. For I know this, that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. Also, from among yourselves, men will arise, speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples after themselves. Therefore, watch and remember that for 3 years I did not cease," this was continual, "to warn everyone night and day with tears. So now, brethren, I command you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I have coveted no one's silver or gold or apparel." Notice with me in verse 18, Paul says this, "In what manner I lived among you." I want you to take notice of what Paul doesn't say here in this verse. He doesn't say, "I want you to know and remember the awesome Bible studies that I taught, how I rightly divided the word of truth." These things are important, but that's not what Paul mentions here to begin with. He calls the elders, these Ephesian elders, to himself, and the first thing that he points to is, "You know what manner of life I lived among you." Now, this is important. Here's why. Because many people today, they don't care how the pastor lives, as long as he can teach the Bible, or he's relevant, or he's funny, or he's engaging, or he aligns with you politically, you know, he's in the same party as you are, whatever. But that's what people are looking for. Okay? Several years ago, let me give you an example. Several years ago, a pastor of a very large church in Florida was found to be committing adultery and also viewing pornography, other things. He was told to step down and he resigned. Now, a good number of people left the church. They were angry. They were really, really upset. They went on national television, interviewed, and they were saying, "You know what? I don't care what he was doing in his personal life. He was funny. He was relevant. His Bible studies were awesome. They were heard by millions of people and were very upset that he left. And they really didn't seem to care the type of lifestyle that he was living. That's a lot of people. His personal life is his personal life. But you know what? Paul put his life on display. He says, I lived among you. I lived among you. He didn't live a double life. He wasn't one way in front of them and a different way behind the curtain. He didn't live a life of isolation like a lot of pastors do today. You don't ever see them. They barely are even there to teach the Bible. You saw how I lived, Paul says. You witnessed my life. Paul's life was his sermon. The man and the message were one. Now notice again, he says, how I lived among you, not above you. Today we live in a culture of celebrity pastors. They don't live among the people. They live above the people. Tight security, gated communities, they're separate from the people. They live way above the people. Listen, I've sat in meetings where we were actually told exactly that, and I've had a lot of ministry experience, crazy pastors and good pastors, and everything in between. I sat in a meeting once where we were actually told that the pastor and his wife were above us, that we were beneath them. I couldn't believe my ears. So contrary to the scriptures. Obviously, I didn't stay in that church long after I heard that. But listen, the pastor's role is to serve the people. Many times that's reversed. The people exist, watch, the people exist to serve the pastor, his wife, and his kids, his family. That's what the whole church exists for, that reason. The pastor's not serving the people. The people are serving the pastor. Isn't it interesting? Jesus said this, I have come not to be served, but to serve. Mark 10, verse 45. The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. Brothers, listen, if you're a pastor, an elder, a deacon, and you're listening to this, your position is not one where you are served. It's one of service where you are serving the people. You're an under-shepherd and the sheep need tending to. In all kinds of areas they need tending to, you are there to serve the people. I'm not going to toot my own horn, but I'm going to give you an example of this and how people think. The very first wedding that I did in this state, I officiated the wedding, and then we went to the reception. And it was a buffet line, and the last like three dishes didn't have a server. Okay, so we were being served, but then the last three, you had to kind of serve yourself. And when I got to the end of that line, the person said, yeah, you got to serve yourself, we're missing a server. And what I did, it was so natural for me, was to take my jacket off, roll up my sleeves, and start serving the people. Well, I was told immediately, Pastor, no. You need to sit in a place of honor with the First Lady. They said, First Lady. I'm like, what? Is the President's wife here? No. The First Lady is your wife. And then, okay, so I'm like, that's ridiculous. No, there's a place that's open for me to serve. I'm going to serve in that place. I gladly served the three dishes that were there at the end of the table. I didn't do that so that, oh, look at Johnny. No, I did that because that's what you do. It should be second nature that you are there, Pastor, I'm speaking to you, and Christian too. You're there to serve others. That's what Christ did. He's our role model. He's everything, right? Notice verse 19. Paul says, I serve the Lord with humility. Remember, Paul says, I was a bondservant among you, and I served my master, Jesus. I served the Lord with humility. I wasn't trying to get your approval or your applause or your accreditation. I wasn't trying for that. I was a good soldier of Jesus Christ, and I was aiming to please him. He later told Timothy the same thing, endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. So here's the interesting dichotomy, I guess the question we should ask ourselves. Does the pastor serve the Lord or the people? I'm here to tell you it's both. He serves the people, but he's governed by the Lord, which means he serves the Lord. So let me give you an example. In many churches, the church government, the way the church is structured to where the pastor is not governed by the Lord or the Word of God. He is governed by a board of elders or by a voting majority, okay? That means that the pastor can only say and do what the congregation says or what's approved by whatever governing board, right? In essence, his hands are tied. That's why in many denominations, you can go to different churches that are all stringed together in the same denomination and you hear the same message. Literally, the higher-ups are giving the message to every church and the pastors have to preach that message so that it's congruent. That's referred to as a puppet pastor, in my opinion. And Paul wasn't a puppet pastor. He wasn't there to please the people and do whatever they approved of. He wasn't there for that. Now listen, here's the balance. Does a pastor need accountability? Absolutely. Absolutely. The pastor shouldn't be allowed to do whatever he wants. Okay? So yes, the pastor needs accountability. That's the balance of that. Some pastors are not puppet pastors. They're master pastor. Do you follow me? Master pastor. Everybody does what he says, whether it's biblical or not, or what she says, right? Because a lot of pastors are women, unbiblical, but that's the truth, right? And so whatever the pastor says, his word or her word supersedes the word of God. Who cares what the word of God says? It's whatever the pastor says that goes. Doesn't matter how crazy or how unbiblical. Mm-hmm. Listen, saints, please listen to me. Brothers, sisters, listen. If next week, next Tuesday, I come in this forum and I say, you know, everybody, go ahead and open with me to the Book of Mormon, page 79. Let's begin reading. Y'all are my brothers and sisters, okay? You have every right, because I'm not above you, I'm among you, to say, yo, Johnny, what's up? Log off, stop listening. Give me a call, shoot me a text. Book of Mormon, have you lost your mind? And listen, there's a governing board at ACF, Abide Christian Fellowship, that would correct me and take care of that. My wife, are you going to let me do that if next week I say, hey, you know what? We got the Watchtower here. Let's start reading that and see what it says.
Absolutely not.
No, of course not, right? So there's balance. There's balance. There's accountability, but the pastor can't have his hands tied. Paul says this very clearly. I serve the Lord among you with humility. Now notice in verses 19 and 23, Paul says this also, I was an example of suffering. Again, this is what we're doing. We're putting flesh and blood to the qualifications of a pastor. The qualifications are the shell of what the man should be. This is the flesh and blood of what the man actually looks like. This is what we read. Paul was an example of suffering. This is what we read in these verses, 19 and 23. Trials, tears, chains, tribulations. The pastor, the servant of God, is a good example. Please listen. A good example of suffering well. The pastor of the church should be a good steward of the trials, of the tribulations, of the multiplied temptations that come his way, and thus provide an example to the flock of suffering well. Did the Apostle Paul do that?
Absolutely.
Oh, he did it with such excellence. He's the one that I want to model myself after. Obviously, like I said, the Lord Jesus, but he's the physical representation of a pastor that the New Testament elevates as a pastor. Listen, here's something else, okay? This is unheard of in a lot of people's ears. Listen, what I'm sharing here is unheard of in a lot of people's ears. The true minister of the Lord Jesus Christ will have trials. That sounds crazy to some people. The true minister of the Lord Jesus Christ, listen to me close, will have trials, will have tears, will have tribulations. Paul the Apostle had plenty. He's the example again of the New Testament pastor. Now, I will tell you, does this not fly in the face of the prosperity gospel, the positive confession doctrine, the declare and decree your destiny into existence, all the nonsense that exists today in the church? This flies in the face of that. Paul suffered well. Paul had plenty of trials. The true minister of the Lord Jesus Christ will suffer tribulation. It's just, it goes with the territory. You know, from time to time, I'll watch commentaries on the TV documentaries, right? On heresies and cults and things of that nature. It was quite a while ago. My wife and I were watching one, this straight up heretic, an impoverished, what wasn't in this country, another third world country, impoverished area. I mean, the people didn't have electricity, no running water, okay, barely had enough to eat. Many families went without eating days on end. So they interview this young woman that's a member of this prosperity church. The guy is a heretic, okay? Much like the ones in the U.S. She was dirt poor. This woman, this poor girl, dirt poor. But she's giving whatever money she had to this reprobate. So they interviewed her and they said, you know, what are you doing? We see how you live. We see how the little money that you make is barely sometimes even able to take care of yourself, much less your family. But why are you giving every last cent to this heretic? You see how he lives. Okay, these are dirt roads, no traffic lights. I'm talking rural, poor, dirt poor. This guy driving BMWs and he lives in a gated mansion like the only one in the whole area. You know what she said? Listen to what she said. Why would I follow? Do you remember this?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, why? She said this. I couldn't believe my ears. Why would I follow a poor, suffering pastor that obviously doesn't know the way of success? Right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what she said. I follow, and she named a heretic, because he can show the way of success. He obviously knows it because he's living it. So that's the example she wanted to have. Obviously, this man, I don't care what he's teaching. I'm looking at his lifestyle, right? And I want to be like him. Obviously, he knows the way, so I'm going to keep giving him money so I can be like him. Can I tell you something? This girl and many like this girl would never follow Paul, Pastor Paul. Never. Because he was poor and suffering all the time. Are you kidding me? Paul, we're talking. Paul was the man who had a messenger of Satan buffeting him continually. A man who was constantly sick. A man who, when he talked, sounded kind of squeaky, you know, his voice. History tells us that. Short, bow-legged, unibrow. He wasn't attractive to look at. His speech was contemptible, etc., etc. She goes, why would I follow that guy? He's poor and he's suffering. Ah, can I tell you somebody else who is poor and suffering? Jesus. Jesus was poor and suffering. That's our Messiah. That's our deliverer. What, are we going to be better than Christ? Am I saying that every pastor should live in poverty, take a vow of poverty? No, I'm not saying that. But you live among the people. This is what I've told young pastors over the years. You must have, take note, you must have the heart of a lamb. What does that mean? The heart of a lamb. Tender, gentle, forbearing, compassionate, kind, long-suffering, the heart of a lamb, non-threatening. You know, people should not feel all kinds of nervous and threatened to come talk to you. No, you have the heart of a lamb. You have the heart of Jesus. You need to have the courage of a lion. You can't back down in adversity. You can't stop preaching the gospel because of persecution or threat of what may happen or not happen, whatever. And then you have to have the skin of an elephant. You have to have thick skin. It's not for the faint of heart. The calling and the equipping are one and the same. If the Lord calls you, he will equip you. What does that mean? He'll give you the heart of a lamb, the courage of a lion, and the skin of an elephant. You don't have to try to produce it. The Lord will produce it in you. Timothy, he's an example in the Bible of that. He didn't have all that. He was a little timid and everything, but Paul said, no, you're called. God will equip you. Don't worry, Timothy. Just trust the Lord and serve him. He's going to equip you to do everything you need to do. Skin of an elephant. You know, people are going to take all kinds of cheap shots at you, at your family. You're going to teach the Bible study. Someone's going to come up to you. You think they were blessed and they just correct what you were wearing. They're going to blast you. They're going to send you anonymous texts. You don't even know who they are. You have an idea, but threatening you and insulting you, all kinds of stuff. You got to be able to take that. Suffer hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. You can't buckle under that type of pressure. Your life can't be precious to you. Nothing moves you. Self-preservation can't exist in your vocabulary. It can't be in your heart or in your mind, period. And God will make you that man. As you follow the Lord, as you stick by his word, God will make you. I don't have to try to make myself that person. I'm not trying to have the heart of a lamb and the courage of a lion. The Lord, through his spirit, is putting that in me. I tell young pastors that. Here's another point in our text. Stay true to the word of God no matter what. No matter what. Verse 20, Paul says this, I held nothing back that was helpful, and I proclaimed it to you publicly and from house to house. Verse 24, my ministry was to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. That was my ministry, not to talk about the latest thing that was happening in the world. Notice with me, he called the Ephesian elders to himself. You know what happened at Ephesus? When Paul arrived at Ephesus, there was a big idolatry problem at Ephesus. Remember Diana, the goddess of the Ephesians? This was the mega church there, okay? People had idols to this goddess Diana. Did Paul go into Ephesus to preach against idolatry? No, he didn't. He went into Ephesus to preach the gospel. You see, some pastors believe that their calling is to preach politics, or their calling is to preach against this or for that. That's not the calling of a pastor. The calling of a pastor, as described in the scriptures, is to proclaim the good news of the grace of God. That's it. Salvation through Jesus and no one else. The gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul was an example of that. Look at what it says here in verse 25. And indeed, now I know that you all among whom I have gone preaching, among, there's that word again, whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God will see my face no more. Paul preached the kingdom of God. That's verse 25. Verse 27, he says, I did not shun to declare the whole counsel of God. Notice the bulk of the ministry of Paul was to warn, to teach doctrine, to proclaim the gospel. And then in verse 31, he says this, I warned you. Paul was constantly, from beginning to end, full of warnings, full of warnings. Read the epistles, the many epistles that Paul wrote in the New Testament. We would have a very thin New Testament if it weren't for the Apostle Paul. But check this, all of them have warnings in them. Can I tell you something? Listen, saints, please listen to me. People hate warnings. They hate warnings. How dare you? It's happened to me multiplicity of times, okay? Out of love, out of tenderness, out of gentleness, I warn someone. Bring a gentle rebuke or a gentle correction, okay? Do you think I get up in the morning and I'm like, you know what? I'm going to go correct somebody today. No, it's not easy for me. It's not something I like to do. But you have to do it. If you're a pastor, you have to warn. And a lot of pastors don't because they don't want to deal with it. I get it. People hate warnings. Are you judging me? No. I'm not judging you. I'm just trying to say, watch your testimony. Hey, you're a witness of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's important. No, you're judging me. And they leave the church or whatever. It's happened to me. It always happens to me. Are you telling me who I should listen to? Who I shouldn't listen to? Listen, I love my heretic. I have all his books. I have all her books. And I don't name a bunch of heretics here because you know what? This is what will happen. If I name the books and I name all the heretics, you know what? I may miss one. And then you think, he didn't mention my heretic, so I'm safe. You see, that could potentially happen. Or if I name some and others are joined, then you don't know what a heretic looks like. I'd rather tell you what they look like, both men and women, so you can be warned. And people do not like warnings. Trust me, they don't like warnings. And Paul's full of warnings here in his last address to these Ephesian elders, verses 29 through 31. Warning. Warnings. To the very end. Paul's warning them to the very end. Now listen to me. If you are a pastor, okay, and you're listening to this, I'm glad you've tuned in. If you don't preach the word of God, if you preach popular opinion, or you preach politics, or you preach only the cotton candy of the Bible, there are doctrines in the Bible that are wonderful, and I love to teach about the grace of God, the love of God, the forgiveness of God. Those are all great. But I also teach the holiness of God. I also teach repentance of sin. That's not the good stuff in a lot of people's ears. And today there are people that are heaping up for themselves, just like Paul says, leaders, pastors, teachers having itching ears. What does that mean when Paul warned Timothy? It means this: you just tell me what I want to hear. A lot of people pick their churches because that pastor is the same skin color as me, or that pastor is aligned with me politically, or that pastor is preaching on the things that I want to hear that are going on in the world. And that's how they choose their church. They don't care about anything else. Woman and pastor, I don't care. Heretic, I don't care. I'm aligned with them. That's it. That's how people pick churches today. But listen, pastor, if you don't want to preach the word of God, and you don't like warning people, and you're governed by people instead of the Lord, right, etc., and your lifestyle is contrary to that of the gospel, please listen to me. You have one or two options. This is my warning to you, young pastor. Take it or leave it. Repent. Okay? One of two options. Repent. Go back to your first love. Start preaching the gospel. Start warning people. Start serving people. Start living in humility before the people. Or step down. Those are the only two options I think you have. Repent or step down. Notice what Paul says. Paul says this in verse 26. I am innocent of the blood of all men. There's only one way that I'm able to say that, and that is if I teach the word of God, proclaim the kingdom of God and the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, I live a life before the people that I'm suffering well, I'm a good steward of trials and tribulations, and I've lived a life before the people and before God that is honorable and in line with the scriptures. I want to be able to say that. And I want you, my dear friend, if you're a leader in the church, to be able to say that as well. I am innocent of the blood. I warned those that needed to be warned. I cautioned those that needed to be cautioned. I proclaimed the gospel to the lost. And I did it with humility. And I lived the life by the grace of God that honored the Lord. I want to be able to say that. Here's another point. The church is not yours. You've heard me say this. The church does not belong to the pastor. The church does not belong to the elder board. Christ purchased it with his own blood. That's what Paul says in verse 28. This was like paramount in his mind. This was at the forefront. I didn't die for the church. I didn't bleed for the church. I can't forgive the church. That's all Jesus. Christ purchased the flock of God with his own blood. You've heard me say it. I'm going to say it again. Therefore, I don't have a mission statement. I don't have a vision. I don't have anything like that for the church. I don't even have a picture of my mug on the website. It's not my church. I don't feel comfortable putting my mug on the website photo. For what? Who cares who the pastor is? Jesus is the pastor of the church. I want to be among the people, blend in with the people. That's where I want to be. Here's the last point, verse 29. The pastor has always his departure in sight. Paul said this, after my departure. Paul was always talking about, like Jesus, about his departure. Jesus was always talking about the hour, right? He would say, my hour has not yet come, because it wasn't close. But when his hour had come, he said, my hour has now come. The pastor should always live with the departure, with his departure in view, in sight. Listen, there's a day coming when I'm going to stand before the Lord. And that produces a holy fear in my heart. How did you treat my people? How did you love them? Were you gentle with them? Were you kind to them? Were you forbearing with them? Did you lash back? Were you angry? Did you teach them? Everything, the whole counsel of God. The things that are easy to teach and the things that are not so easy to teach. Or were you intrepidatious, like, well, you know, I better not say that because these people may leave and they give a lot of money, or these people may be offended. A lot of pastors, they don't teach on things they need to teach in the church. They don't teach about gossip. They don't teach about any of the things that can bring any kind of ruffling among the sheep. Why? Because people are giving a lot of money and they're living in adultery, or they're gossipers or slanderers, whatever, but don't say anything. They may leave the church. Is that how you lived your life? Is that what concerned you, Johnny? Or was it my heart towards my people? Did you warn them? How about those that didn't know the Lord? Did you proclaim to them the good news? I want to be able to say, listen, Lord, I fulfilled my ministry by your grace, right? And the Bible says this, let not many be teachers, for they shall receive a stricter judgment. That puts a fear in my heart. That puts a holy fear in my heart. That's a big accountability, big responsibility. And can I tell you something else? I'll close with this. Sorry, it's a bit long, but listen, when a pastor loses the fear of the Lord, they're capable of anything. I've seen it with my own eyes. And I'm talking anything from gambling the church's money away, to doing drugs, addicted, to substances, letting their children do whatever they want in the church, whatever they want, fornication. Okay, they're even on staff. Just crazy things. And it's all because of this. That man has lost the fear of the Lord. Now they're in isolation. Now it's anything goes, and it's a tragedy. It's a sad tragedy that I've witnessed with my own eyes on more than one occasion. So listen, this is a message about the silhouette of a pastor and the flesh and bone that gets put on in the New Testament through the Apostle Paul. I pray it's encouraged you. If you know a leader, if you know a pastor, an elder that could benefit from this, send it to them, you know. And I've never said to share anything like this, but we're living in desperate days. We're living in dark, desperate days. And a lot of good men of God have lost their way, and they've succumbed to a lot of pressures and temptations. So I pray this is an encouragement to you as a Christian and to my fellow brothers who are leaders, called to be leaders, shepherds, under shepherds of God's flock. May the Lord richly bless you, Lord willing. See you on Saturday.